Welcome to join us today. We're having a video today that we want to share with you on important issues that we need to address during our pandemic. And obviously, we've talked about education, we've talked about sports, we've talked about health. One of the things I wanted to bring out today, and I brought two local experts in, I wanted to talk about domestic violence and sexual abuse and what has happened in our communities and in our state over the last 5 months and what's really going on. So today I'd like to welcome Paolo Sereccia, and I'm gonna get that name right, Sereccia. Paolo is the manager of a wonderful new organization, a new center called the Hope Family Justice Center. And she's the manager of it. It's in New Haven, Connecticut. And then also Jennifer Wenderorth-Holster, who I've talked to many times before, who just took over as the new director of the Sexual Assault Crisis Services for Women and Family Life in Meriden. But both these people these women have worked so hard in this field, and they're experts, and I thought it'd be really important for us to have this discussion. So welcome, ladies. Welcome to today.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much.
I'm trying to get you both all on. Okay, good. Anyway, I wanted to start off with first welcome you, obviously. But it's amazing. Here we have two local people that are so involved in this critical issue and issues. So I'd like to start with throwing it out to both of you. Over the last 5 months, people have stayed home. People have been really quarantined on the whole, especially in the beginning. What have you found with your area of expertise of what's going on in our community? Paolo, do you want to start?
Sure. The Hope Family Justice Center is really a movement across the world, and there's over 100 family justice centers, and it's really to be able to assist families that are dealing with abuse and how to best respond and working with systems. We provide free wraparound services and care that are trauma responsive. During the last 5 months, our victims have been confined to their homes with the abusers and their children as well, without any reprieve or respite. We have found that actually, a trend has been is an increase of shootings, an increase of stalking, increase of strangulation, relocation, and housing, emergency housing and long-term housing. We have found that there are more hospitalizations due to the seriousness of their injury and more forensic exams needing to happen. At the beginning of COVID-19, due to the stay-at-home orders, they have been confined. Isolated even more so, difficult to be able to reach out. But in the last couple of months, calls have increased. All our partners, we have over 26 partners, which Jennifer is one of our partners, the Women and Family Center, to provide the sexual assault piece. But we are able to work with law enforcement, legal supports, basic needs, community action, mental health providers, medical providers, housing specialists, social service specialists, and even faith-based and wellness organizations to provide these free wraparound services. So right now, the biggest need is housing. It is needs for basic needs, for relocation, for food, for baby essentials, and children essentials, as now we start thinking about having them go back to school.
Thank you, Paolo. Jennifer, you want to jump in?
Sure, absolutely. Thank you, Noreen. So what we have seen on particularly the shoreline with in regards to sexual assault during the last couple months during the pandemic is we are seeing an increase in hotline services, people reaching out to the hotline. I can tell you that RAIN, an organization that has hotlines all throughout the United States, they've actually seen their highest increase in 26 years during this pandemic. And that half of the people that are reaching out for services are minors. And that's something that we are seeing. And that's because a lot of times when there is sexual violence that's occurring, we know usually it's with, for children, it's with somebody that they love and they trust, and it's a family member or somebody connected to the family. So when they're in school and teachers and coaches, they're the ones usually catching this, why it's going on. This isn't happening. And while children have been at home remote learning and the parents think that they're doing work, they're actually reaching out over the internet looking for services because what's going on in the homes. We have seen a decrease with college sexual assault and assault stemming from, you know, parties and bars, because bars are shut down. Colleges are basically all telecommuting. But colleges are starting to go back in session. So we're kind of preparing for that. And with colleges actually quarantining people from the hotspots. But there's been an increase in just people reaching out to talk with somebody over our hotline. Even our regular clients, they're looking for more services because they may be at home with their abuser may be a partner. There's an increase in sexual exploitation from employers not saying, you know, I'm not going to terminate you during this time, and then using it as a sexual tool. Same with landlords and tenants. Landlords or tenants not understanding that the rights, they can't be kicked out during this pandemic for not paying their rent. But again, it's being used as a sexual exploitation tool. With women and family, we have continued nonstop offering our 24-hour, 7 days a week, 365 days a year hotline. Some things during the pandemic we have not really been allowed to do is actually go into the hospitals during the evidence collection kit. And that is something that we do offer. We just actually got the okay as of last week that some of the hospitals will start allowing us in. And we have gone into hospitals this week for evidence collection kits. Things with police station and courts, they've still been happening, but there's a lot more fears coming from victims. Can I go in? Can I have it? Will a kit be done? Is my court case going to go on? Am I just going to catch COVID going into some place? So typical concerns that weren't coming up for victims before are now on top of all the fears that they were facing before. So we are still working on our hotline. We are offering telecommuting, crisis counseling. If people want to come in, our Meriden office has been open throughout the whole pandemic, and people can come and do set up their crisis counseling. We're doing a telehealth, over the phone, all different ways. We're still working with our police and our courts and our community centers. We have a bed that we actually house victims in, and that's being utilized more than it has in the past because people are needing, sexual assault victims are also needing a place to rest their head at night. So there has been quite an increase in certain areas that we work with, and we've seen a decrease in others, but just the overall need that is absolutely been growing during this time, unfortunately.
And if I can piggyback on Jenny, is just with the wonderful work that she does, the court system has been an issue because New Haven Court has been closed. And so the only ways to be able to find a restraining order is actually doing it online. But just like Jennifer said, our hotlines have increased, our lethality assessment program where officers go onto the scene and call an advocate because there's a domestic and there's a lethality issue, that has increased. And so having to deal with court systems being closed, clients not knowing how to access those emergency custody orders or restraining orders, or even understanding what the process is, we are also continuing to provide those services. We definitely have the domestic violence shelters that have been full and continue to fill up. But then with COVID, it's also those parameters as well, as people are afraid to go to some of the domestic violence shelters because afraid contacting COVID. And we also have our elderly program, which is our CHERISH program. And that is something that is very dear to us and it's very essential. We have elderly people that are feeling alone, isolated. They were feeling that way before. And now with COVID, they're afraid for their lives.
Paula's absolutely correct. The isolation is the biggest thing for the domestic violence and sexual assault victims. What some people might not know with our member centers and the clients that we serve, so while we are primarily sexual assault, a lot of our sexual assault victims do deal with some form of domestic violence. Their sexual assault abusers could be their partner. So that's where the cross with for us with the domestic violence, and for Paula when they're dealing with domestic violence cases, a form of domestic violence is sexual assault. So we're very fortunate that Women and Families and Hope Family Justice have such a close relationship, and Paula and I just, we hit it off and we really do whatever we can for our staff and our victims. But it's been an interesting time, and it's important that people realize that why they might be not seeing these things or hearing about it so much on the media, the truth is you never even hear like 1% of what's really going on. So right now you're not even hearing anything of really what's going on. And the sad part is it's on the rise right now for both centers.
Yeah.
You know, I'm really really kind of surprised by a lot of this information. A lot of us have been concerned. And actually what I thought you were going to tell me is, you know, there's problems out there and you're not hearing about them, but that's not what you told me. Because
well,
people
it is.
Isolated.
Well, it is happening, unfortunately. Sorry. I mean, that is the case. There's people that are just so scared to reach out. And that's always been the case. There's just people that can't reach out or too scared. And now with the fact that perpetrators living at home are controlling people's access to computers and their phones, so they are more scared to reach out than ever. So the sad truth is the numbers are probably way higher than what we are seeing. But the fact is people, they don't have that ability to reach out. I'm sorry to cut you off, but yeah, so it is unfortunately those things.
That's so important. You know, one of the things that, go ahead, Paula.
I'm sorry, Noreen.
No, that's okay, go for it.
And that's why we're seeing more calls on shootings, more calls on stalking, more calls on strangulations, and these higher injury hospitalizations, where part of the discharge plan is to get them hooked up with the Hope Family Justice Center and Women and Families, because a lot of our victims are dealing with both the domestic violence, interpartner violence, and sexual assault. And so really right now, it's about a collaboration between all systems and all partners to be able to access these services directly and immediately. And that, I have to say, I have not heard of any gaps in services by either partners or clients. People are getting called back immediately. Advocates, both sexual assault and domestic, are working nonstop. And even though we have to also think about is the staff as well too, and protecting them, and how Jennifer and I have worked on building our systems with our leaders to be able to create a safe space so that they could come in, because we do have walk-ins and we do have scheduled appointments again. We want to make sure that everybody's safe, clients and staff alike.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, it's so wonderful to hear you working together. I have to, both of you have mentioned your partners. Could you tell us, like, what are the groups that you work with? How far reaching is this?
So for Women and Family, we serve 28 towns. So like Shoreline, New Haven County, Middlesex County. So kind of the areas is like all the way down to through Old Saybrook, all the way up to New Haven, the Middlesex, Meriden area, all the way through East Haddam. So we are 26, we serve 26 towns with our 24/7 hotline, hospital accompaniments, police accompaniments, courts accompaniments, protective orders, throughout all the agencies that you can think of in these 28 towns in regards to schools, colleges, doctor's offices, gynecologists, religious, different religious affiliations. It's all, that's all in those 28 towns. We work with them all.
And they know to contact you when a patient comes in. What about you, Paula?
The same thing. Our catchment areas from Madison to Ansonia, but we do will service anybody from the state. A lot of people are coming from out of state as well too, which has been a big increase on relocation because they're fleeing from abuse. And so for us, we have over 26 partners involved. That means that we have MOUs, memorandum contracts together, that we're going to work together as partners to make sure that they're accessing the services immediately. And so that could mean that you have one client that comes in and you have DCF, Women and Family Services, Umbrella Center, the police stations, the detectives, the special victims unit, the attorneys. I mean, and then you have basic needs like community action agencies and people that are going to be able to provide the housing and the employment as well too, because they are being pushed to not go out to work and to stay home so that they're more controlled by the perpetrators. So we really look at it as a holistic view of wrapping the family around with all the needs. And it's not just for the client. It's for their children. It's for their grandparents. It's for anybody that is affected by the abuse. And so when we really think about one client and how many people are affected and how many partners do we really need to get involved, to hold them, to be compassionate with them, and to know that there's hope for a better quality of life. And that's really the biggest message we want to give. And I'm sure Jennifer feels the same. And why we're doing this is we want to say, we are here for you. There are people that care that are here for you 24/7. And no matter what, we're not going to give up until you're able to get the services and care that you really need.
Yeah, absolutely. It's important that people know that they're not alone during this. And it's not just a one type situation thing. There are so many different key things that are at play here, different services. It's not like we're just addressing sexual assault or they're just addressing domestic violence. There are so many aspects that go into when somebody comes in looking for services. So it's really important working within the community. And like Paula said, not just for the straight victims themselves, but for their family, for both primary and secondary victims.
And I want to thank you both. We're so fortunate on the Shoreline to have you folks be our neighbors and be here. But as you both have said, you reach way beyond and really statewide what you're doing. This is so important. And I want people watching this video to know at the end, we're going to have all the contact information for you, for both organizations, for both of these dynamic, wonderful women that are doing such important work. And as they said, it's not just for the abused, it's for the whole family. And, you know, I had hoped when we were all isolated, things would be quieter, but it certainly didn't turn out that way. And I know we've been concerned. I talked to the Commission on Children and Family, Department of Children and Family, and said to them, their call centers and stuff, things, the call lines are quieter. And he said, that does not mean that we don't have as many cases. It means that a lot of the mandated reporters, such as teachers, aren't doing it. But we're also finding more of the calls we get really materialize into a serious problem. And so those numbers haven't gone down. So let's just end this. If you both want to just make some closing remarks. And as I said, we're inviting everybody to pay attention and really keep this, read these resources that you'll find at the end of this video. And Jennifer and Paulo, you're doing such good work, important work. And I can't think of two more dynamic women that I respect and I look forward to working with. So do you both want to just say something briefly to kind of end our video and close it? Jennifer, you want to go first?
Sure. So the Women and Family Center, we right now we're all working out of our Meriden office. We do have a satellite office in Middletown and New Haven. Again, we serve the Shoreline, the New Haven County, the Middlesex County. We do have a hotline staffed by sexual assault certified crisis counselors. You can call 7 days a week, every day, holidays, anytime you want. Our direct hotline number where you can reach us is 203-235-4444. We are going out to hospitals. We are working with the police departments, the courts. If you just need somebody to talk to, whatever you need, please do not hesitate to reach out. You can find us at womenfamilies.org. We just really want you to know that we're here to help you with no matter what you need, to help you gain that power and control back, and to know that you are not alone and it was not your fault.
Thank you, Paula.
Wow, Jen, you basically said it all.
That's pretty amazing.
Jennifer. It's really about knowing people are together and that people actually really care. A lot of people that do this job is because of their heart, and they really want to give back. And so we want you to know that not only are you not, but we are here to help. Our phone number at the Hope Family Justice Center is 203-800-7204. And you can catch us on our website at bhcare.org, and then you'll come up to the Hope Family Justice Center. And just really remember that you have strengths, just a victim, but you will become not only a survivor, but a thriver. And we will get the community together to be able to support you in anything you need. Just Jennifer.
I don't think I could add anything to your thoughts and your comments. So I want to thank you both. I hope people really, really pay attention and get help if they need it. Reach out. You're not alone. Just look at these two amazing women, and there's more like them all over the state. So thank you. Thank you, Paula. Thank you, Jennifer. I look forward to doing future videos with you with this, since you're doing such important work. Goodbye now.
Bye. Thank you.